Good evening and welcome everybody. I'm Lucy Murphy. My pronouns are she, her, hers, and I'm an organizer with the Claudia Jones School for Political Education based in Washington, D.C. And we're excited to host tonight's event, Black Women, Black Radicalism, and the Black Midwest. For those who are unaware, the Claudia Jones School for Political Education is a popular educational organization committed to building political consciousness in the DC metropolitan community. We strive to be a force in the fight against injustice, against the relentless class war against the working poor, whose labor is the source of all capital that is used against the same workers in furthering their exploitation. The Claudia Jones School creates spaces for folks to engage in radical politics and further develop their class and socialist consciousness. We'd also like to acknowledge the people upon whose land the Claudia Jones School exists. This is the land of the Nacotchtank people, from which the name Anacostia is drawn. The closest surviving First Nations people are the Piscataway Nation. The Piscataways hold their annual celebrations in Accokeek, Maryland. And now to introduce our presenter for tonight, I'd like to welcome Dr. Melissa Ford to Claudia Jones School. She's an assistant professor at Slippery Rock University in Slippery Rock, Pennsylvania. She received her PhD in American Studies from St. Louis University and a BA in Political Science and Philosophy from Wellesley College. Dr. Ford is a fifth generation Midwesterner born in St. Louis. She currently lives in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. Her research interests are Black radicalism, Black women's history, the Black Midwest, and labor history. Her first book, Black Women's Activism in the Midwest During the Great Depression, will be published with Southern Illinois University. Early 2022. And with that, let's welcome Dr. Melissa Ford.
Thank you so much, Lucy. And I love the way you say St. Louis. So I'll hear that in my dreams tonight. So thank you so much. And I want to thank the Claudia Jones School for Political Education for hosting me this evening. Tonight, I'll be giving a short presentation on Maude White and Tyra Edwards, two radical African-American women who challenged racial, gender, and class oppression during the Great Depression. Their activities often centered around the American Communist Party, and though they did not depend on the party nor the Soviet Union to dictate their actions, beliefs, passions for justice, instead, women like Maude White and Edwards, Tyra Edwards, who participated in communist activities, blended their personal and regional histories, their lived experiences, their ideas of gender and racial equality with party doctrine in a way that established them as important activists during the Great Depression. Now, Maude White and Tyra Edwards were not alone. Thousands of Black women worked for and with the Communist Party in the Midwest during the 1930s. Every individual woman approached her activism differently. There was Ida Carter here, who bypassed her local church leaders on Chicago's South Side and organized a strike in coordination with national communist leaders, seeing it through to a successful conclusion. Carrie Smith in St. Louis, Missouri, stood in front of the city hall and rallied her fellow workers out of complacency and fear into militant action. She hoisted a brick in one hand and a Bible in the other and declared, "Girls, we cannot lose," in their pursuit of racial and economic justice. Mattie Woodson of Detroit officially joined the Communist Party and hosted clandestine auto worker union meetings in her home, risking her life, job, and reputation. And after an anti-eviction riot left two of her comrades dead, Maggie Jones in Cleveland organized a nurses' brigade that trained in first aid in order to avoid such future tragedy. Thousands of other Black women in the Midwest faded in and out of the Communist Party, attending rallies and protests, but never officially joining the party or making the pages of the communist records. When examined through a lens of gender, race, class, and region, the history of these women, Black radicalism, and the Communist Party during the Great Depression takes on a new historical importance that challenges how we understand American racial and working class history and activism today. Now, because gender, race, class, and region are essential parts of this study, yet we're not always central to Communist Party's activity, I decided to use a new term that would best represent these women's activism. Therefore, I offer Midwestern Black radicalism, theorized as a distinct expression of praxis-based Black radical ideology, informed by American communism, as well as African-American community building, Black women's history of resistance, and lived experiences of Black women in the Midwest during the Great Depression. Now, Midwestern Black radicalism refers to more than just the location where these radical activists organized and agitated. Rather, this particular interpretation of Black radicalism is sharped by many factors: urban development, industrialization, patterns of migration and residency, interactions of race, class, and gender in social spaces. These form the foundation for expressions of Midwestern Black radicalism. As well, individual stories make it come alive. And most importantly, African-American women are at the hearts of this overlooked radicalism in the heartland. As such, Midwestern Black radicalism interrogates the crossroads of African-American history, gender studies, labor history, Midwestern studies, and really calls for a profound reimagining of how we remember and interpret these women's stories today. Tonight, I am briefly presenting two introductions to the remarkable lives of Maud White and Tyra Edwards. These two African-American women come from Midwestern backgrounds, closely worked with the Communist Party, traveled extensively in Europe and the Soviet Union to receive truly radical and unique educations. They both represented important links between the party's radical third period and the coalition building popular fronts. They were central thinkers on how race, class, and gender overlapped and how this intersectionality informed Black radicalism. Of course, though, their lives were very different. After establishing themselves as well-known activists in the Midwest, they continued on different paths to pursue knowledge, justice, and peace. Those familiar with American communist history might be more familiar with their work done in New York and on the international stage. And certainly their continued activism after 1940 deserves its own evening and presentation. Tonight, though, I plan to briefly introduce them and their work in the Midwest during the 1930s to demonstrate the complexity and spectrum of Midwestern Black radicalism. In doing so, I hope to highlight certain areas and certain regions of Black radical activity that have been ignored in the past, and ultimately show that radical activism in the Black Midwest did not start in Ferguson or Minneapolis, but has roots that run much, much deeper. So to begin, here's some brief American communist history to help us better understand the positionality of these women in the party. In 1929, the Soviet-controlled International Communist Party, or the Comintern, signaled an ideological transition for communist parties around the world. Party members, especially those in the United States, would start to develop their own radical unions. This was a remarkable switch, as the previous decade saw them trying to bore from within in mainstream liberal organizations and unions. This 1929 transition into the third period was also marked by the added emphasis on the importance of African-American women and African-American women in the working class struggle. Then fast forward 5 years later, the party would again switch gears and enter into what was known as the Popular Front era, where the rise of fascism and war in Europe presented such a threat that radical communists started to work with mainstream liberal groups. The transition from being a standalone radical organization to a member of a group was difficult for some party members. But better than anybody, Maud White represented the link between third period communists and the new Popular Front movement. Maud White was born in McKeesport, Pennsylvania, about 15 minutes from where I sit now, a coal mining town about half an hour southeast of Pittsburgh. Through encouragement of a progressive white teacher, Maud moved to Chicago, joined the Communist Party, and visited the Soviet Union at the party's invitation. this sort of trip wasn't unusual. As we'll see, many African Americans who exhibited promise, according to the Communist Party, would study in the Soviet Union and other European countries during this time. And after returning from the Soviet Union, Maud White settled in New York City. There, she was the only African American woman leader in a in a leadership position in the Communist Party's union boards, as well as the editor of the Harlem Liberator. Here she is, pictured in a riot near City Hall, where several of her comrades were arrested. However, she managed to escape and also managed to catch the lens of this photographer with an excellent photo that I absolutely love. This photo also encapsulates her fighting spirit, because although she was a devout member of the Communist Party, she had no qualms in fiercely challenging racism and sexism among party and union members. She wrote an article in 1931 called, quote, "Against White Chauvinism in the Philadelphia Needle Trades," and she lambasted what she called, quote, "negrophobia" in union organizing, as well as general party membership. Perhaps this agitation and airing of dirty laundry marked her as a persona non grata, because even after her substantial contributions and leadership in New York, at age 28 in 1934, she was reassigned to the less desirable district of Cleveland as section organizer. And this is where we enter with Midwestern Black radicalism and why the Midwest matters. Cleveland in particular offered an opportunity for Maud White to return to her industrial roots. And the smaller city offered her opportunities for closer relationships with moderate organizations, which she immediately embarked on. She forged relationships with the NAACP, Cleveland's Urban League, the YMCA, and even local churches welcomed her, despite her well-known status as a communist. However, it was her membership of the Future Outlook League that was her chance to most effect change in her new city. The Future Outlook League was established in 1935 with the general role to help Black workers get jobs. About 20 years after, they would have this wonderful mural painted on the side of a building in Cleveland, and that still stands today. With White's involvement, the Future Outlook League went beyond job placement. She took her activist training and put it to use and was active in organizing protests for Black employment. Her neighborhood committee successfully picketed racist store owners, organized boycotts, and eventually forced local A&P stores to employ Black workers. She held sessions specifically for Black women on how to organize picket lines and boycotts. And these training sessions were highly successful because during the protests, women would often be employed to send food in to picketers or to serve as shock troops, basically picketers who would come in and fill in gaps in the line. Now, this sort of activism is familiar to us perhaps in the 50s or 60s, but White, remember, was doing this in 1935 in Cleveland. She was not even content to limit her activism to employment only. In 1935, she, along with several other women, organized a committee to protest a segregated swimming pool with the slogan, quote, "Make Woodhill Swimming Pool Safe for Colored People or Close It." They inspired the community to stir into action. Since its opening in 1927, the Woodhill Pool had been a contested site where several fights left African-American swimmers beaten and banned from the pool. However, with untiring zeal, as one newspaper put it, Maud White gained endorsement from 12 African-American organizations and 14 Hungarian organizations in the area that really showed her skills as a coalition builder. The pool was then desegregated, however, basically in name only, as it would continue to be a violent site for another two decades and the site for continued protests. Maud White, however, went on to continue her activism in Cleveland. She led a neighborhood committee which continued to fight racism in coordination with other groups. She would often address Black Clevelanders at mass meetings, explaining her committee's work and how the organizations could work together. In one spirited meeting, she debated politics with members of the Republican and Democratic parties, presenting a very convincing argument as to why Black Clevelanders should join the Communist Party. With her organizing experience, her education, her training, Maud White was the bridge between radical and moderate groups, exemplifying Popular Front era of cooperation, but also enduring ideas of Black radicalism and racial justice. Because while she was working with other groups to fight employment and non-discrimination, she continued her fight against white chauvinism, labor exploitation, and capitalism. As secretary for Cleveland's division of the League of Struggle for Negro Rights, she had led a crowd of several hundred people to a council member's home address. There, in front of his home, they demanded several things. First, a new trial for a Black man who was accused of robbery and fined the exorbitant amount of $200. Second, an investigation regarding discrimination against African Americans on relief. Third, a recent police shooting of a local Black man, and a study on the poor housing conditions of majority Black neighborhoods. After negotiations, again, right outside this council member's home, White was able to procure a new trial for the man accused of robbery, as well as promises for investigations into other racial injustices. Now, confronting a councilman at his home was not a move in the NAACP's playbook or the Future Outlook League's playbook, but it was a common activity among communists, a tactic of which Maud White was well aware. White and many others active in the League of Struggle for Negro Rights were absorbed into the burgeoning National Negro Congress. White was one of the first proponents of the NNC, the National Negro Congress, in Cleveland. And February of 1936, she spoke with other members, sponsoring a committee to rally support for the organization. And just a few days later, she, accompanied by 23 other delegates, made their way to Chicago for the inaugural convention of the NNC. And she attended as a member of the National Executive Council. White's contributions during the first official proceedings are unfortunately not known. She likely helped craft the NNC's official declaration on African American women, recognizing the importance of Black women in the struggle for workers' rights. And of course, this was something she had been advocating for 5 years with the Communist Party. On returning from the convention, White was dedicated to pressing the NNC's vision. She attended several meetings of the local Housewife League to report on the NNC. She spoke at a mass meeting of the Ethiopian League and hosted a banquet in honor of well-known Black communist Louise Thompson. By not limiting her activism to only radical operations, White embraced and excelled at the popular era coalition building. She continued to work on behalf of the NNC, appointed as labor chairman of the Cleveland Council of the NNC. And in June of 1936, the Cleveland Council sponsored a meeting for the Congress where White wore many hats, first as a labor chair, then as a representative of the Cleveland Teachers Union, and then as a featured speaker. Among those she spoke to were former vice presidential candidate James Ford, well-known communist Angelo Herndon, local representatives from the board of directors of the NAACP, workers' unions, and members of the Future Outlook League. Her inclusion in such a well-known panel of speakers shows how important her voice had become to radical and mainstream organizations in Cleveland. Her devotion to the working class soon found her heavily involved in the burgeoning Congress of Industrial Organizations, or the CIO. White was one of the many communists the CIO pursued for leadership roles, and the steelworkers especially, in particular, welcomed communists, as they had been active in large steel cities with large Black populations, like Cleveland, Pittsburgh, and Chicago, areas where White had lived and worked. White was well known for her work in Cleveland and so was selected to the Steelworkers Organizing Committee, or SWOC. There was a large number of Black steelworkers in Cleveland that in some cases were earning 15 to 25 cents less an hour than white workers on the same job. And this injustice spurred Maud White to action, and she joined the SWOC chairman and toured industry-heavy cities across the Midwest to address all Black crowds and speaking to the importance of unions. White toured the Midwest, and her commitment and public appearances helped convince Black workers to elect her to secretary of the National Conference of Negro Organizations Convention in Pittsburgh in 1937, which can only seem as a bit of a homecoming. Likely, White exchanged notes with other prominent women at the meeting, like Tyra Edwards, who we'll talk about in a minute. In 1940, Maud White moved to New York to better center her radical work around the New York office section. She married Arthur Katz, a white communist, and was known as Maud White Katz. Though far from her roots in the industrial Midwest, White Katz continued to emphasize coalition building and how intersecting identities can inform Black women's radical activism. Her efforts in pursuit of justice were relentless. In 1949, she led the effort to help release Rosalie Ingram, a sharecropper who had received the death penalty for killing her white attacker in self-defense. In the 1960s, she joined the Negro Women's Action Committee and wrote for the leading Black publication, Freedom Ways, on politics and culture. In New York City, she led the fight to end racism in New York City's public schools. However, White found that the party's promises of race and gender equality often fell short of reality. In a 1981 interview, 3 years before her death, she noted that, quote, in spite of stated programs of the Radical Party set about equality, women were relegated to Jimmy Higgins' work. Jimmy Higgins' work here refers to the novel by Upton Sinclair, meaning the unromantic side of organizing, the leafleting, the secretarial work, rarely taking the podium to speak or writing the front page column. She continued, quote, very few were accepted into leading positions. For Black women, it was especially blatant. And so White drifted away from the Communist Party, but she continued to consider herself a socialist and a radical and fought for working class Black women her entire life. With her work through the National Negro Congress and the Steelworkers Organizing Committee, she came, this is one last picture of Maude White in the 1960s. With her work, she came across well-known activist Tyra Edwards. During a period of a few years during the 1930s, Tyra Edwards was one of the most sought-after Black women speakers in the Midwest. She appeared before unions, Black sororities, international dinner parties, women's clubs, political rallies. She spoke to a diversity of audiences, crossing boundaries of race and class, gender, politics. She was a social worker, an international traveler, and she was an engaging speaker with many interesting stories to tell. However, I think the most interesting story is her own. She was born in Texas and raised in a middle-class family that instilled values of justice, honesty, and action. After graduating high school, she spent a few years teaching in Houston public schools, but in 1919 embarked on her career as a social worker that would take her from Texas to Gary, Indiana. Edwards' involvement and contributions to the Black families of Gary led the Chicago Defender to label her as one of the, quote, most widely known social workers in the country. She earned a vacation in 1929, I think she definitely earned it, and toured Europe. And while seeing the great sights and cities of France, Italy, Austria, and England, the stock market crashed and sent the working class into a state of panic and despair. Returning to Gary, Indiana, Edwards witnessed the increasing racial tensions, economic strife, and limitations of government institutions. Edwards noted her increasing disillusionment with the North. In 1931, almost after 12 years of social work in Gary, Edwards left the city for Chicago and the next step of her radical education. In Chicago, she made her home in an interracial settlement house in the tradition of Jane Addams' Hull House. Located in the traditionally Black working class neighborhood, the center brought Edwards in direct contact with Chicago's neediest families. She was soon introduced to social workers and community organizers who worked closely with the nation's most famous African-American labor union, the Brotherhood of the Sleeping Car Porters. The Brotherhood's successes were not limited to the workplace only, though. The Brotherhood had formed a strong network of African-Americans dedicated to the Black working class solidarity. Part of the success of these neighborhood networks was due to the Citizens Committee, which sought to encourage connections between the workers and their community. And seeing the success of forging such ties, Edwards readily joined the committee in 1932. The burst of Black working class agitation, spurred by the Great Depression and fostered by these protest networks, introduced Edwards to a new and different way to fight for Black workers. She later wrote during this time that her life was defined by, quote, introduction to the radical movement and its conflicting schools of thought, unquote. Edwards began to look towards socialism and communism as alternative and complements, not necessarily opposites to her social work. Even her friends could tell her ideas about social welfare were changing during this time. One friend remembered, quote, it seemed to Tyra that the programs of social agencies were inadequate to address the problems we faced, unquote. At this point in her life, Edwards began to turn her attention to labor and how issues of racial and social justice must be built from the ground up. In her never-ending pursuit of higher education, Edwards attended Brookwood Labor College in upstate New York, where she studied economics, labor history, public speaking, and journalism under the direction of noted labor organizer, minister, and pacifier, A.J. Mustey. The school trained workers to become experienced labor organizers, and in small classes, students read extensively on the history and present conditions of labor throughout the world. When she returned to Chicago in 1933, Edwards brought with her a deeper understanding of the history of labor, as well as practical solution to organize Black workers in Chicago. Her time on the South Side was cut short, however, because the Brotherhood of Sleeping Car Porters soon recommended her for a fellowship for another educational opportunity, this time at the International People's College, a folk school in Denmark. She soon immersed herself in her studies, which included an introduction to Danish labor issues, Scandinavian literature, Danish folk schools, and cooperative adult education. While receiving an excellent education in issues surrounding the international working class, Edwards always had her eye on the unfolding events in the United States. Edwards was very wary of FDR's New Deal and government promises, as she has personally witnessed the limitations of those programs in her work with her social work families. And as her global education progressed, she began to question American approaches and pointed to workers' educational programs that Scandinavian countries championed. With this sort of education and focus on workers' collective good, Edwards noted, workers did not necessarily depend or need to depend on the welfare of a liberal government. When she returned to Chicago in 1935, she was one of the most educated, well-known, well-prepared women in Chicago to lead the next stage of the workers' collective action. And the International Ladies Garment Workers Union knew that. The ILGWU asked Edwards to help organize workers at the Sopkin dressmaking factories on Chicago's South Side. Well-known Black socialist Frank Crossraith would take the lead, but it was Edwards who rallied the mostly Black women to embrace their collective power as workers. The Sopkin shops and their owner, Ben Sopkin, were no stranger to labor agitation. In 1933, so 2 years previously, over 1,500 workers, mostly African-American women, staged a successful strike with the aid of local members of the Communist Party. They endured police violence on the picket lines, degradation from local Black community members, and the stigma from being associated with communism. However, the women bravely endured. After 2 weeks of striking, the Sopkins management agreed to all terms presented by the workers' representatives. Now, fast forward 2 years later, when Crossraith and Edwards entered the Sopkin factories, they found that conditions had not much improved from before the 1933 strike. Though the agreement had allowed unions, no union had been formed. Experienced workers were fired without notice, replaced by low-wage, unskilled workers without any union representation, and therefore no recourse. Upon learning the details of the situation, Edwards turned toward her journalistic impulse. In the March 1935 issue of Crisis, she published a scathing article sarcastically titled, "Let Us Have More Like Mr. Sopkin." The reason why there's no union representation in the Sopkin shops, according to Edwards, was due to Ben Sopkin's, quote, "sparing neither pains nor money," end quote, to see that the workers would join only the company union. The Sopkin company union could limit the workers' rights, and under Sopkin's watchful eye, the workers served more as propaganda than people. Sopkins instituted a loyalty week where large white posters took over the South Side restaurants and shops reading, quotes, "be loyal to your family, be loyal to your friends, be loyal to your community, be loyal to your government, be loyal to your church, but most of all, be loyal to your job." Signs were everywhere on the South Side. Not only that, Black church leaders were brought in during lunch hours to preach to the women with sermons titled, quote, loyalty to Mr. Sopkins, who for 25 years has been like a father to the Negro women on the South Side, letting them work in his factories on his machines. Mm. Edwards had something to say about it too. In her no holds barred journalistic style, she sardonically commented, quote, "well, so did old massa in slavery, what of it?" Throughout her critique, Edwards was quick to liken the Black women workers' situation to that in slavery. In a second article on the topic, she noted the accommodationist tactics of local Black leaders, such as former Congressman Oscar DePriest, local Black social workers, whom she used to work with, and religious leaders who were quick to side with Ben Sopkins. Their efforts, she argued, directly undermined the struggle and sacrifice of the workers and kept them uninformed and divided. She accused these Black leaders of tolerating rather than challenging unjust racial practices. She noted, quote, Uncle Tom did not originate in fiction, nor did he die with the Emancipation Proclamation. He's perpetualized and immortalized in the type of leadership that sells the Negro for a few sound American dollars. Edward's strong public denunciation of local politicians, care workers, and religious work leaders shows her break with traditional notions of social work, that working through government institutions and respecting Black leaders, you can achieve desirable results. Instead, Edwards advocated a more radical positioning, a position that these issues of discrimination must be addressed at their core. White owners exploited Black workers in a capitalist system that rewarded that behavior. Uninformed and unorganized workers stood little chance against this racist and classist system. Though employers and the government tried to mitigate the effects through welfare programs, social agencies, and contributions to church and community centers, she argues, though, that their disingenuous efforts have only left Black workers, quote, clinging to the frayed skirts of their employer. Edwards' condemnation of moderate Black leaders and their support of the oppressive system of white capitalism rejects traditional institutions and notions of racial uplift. Instead, progress must be fought for at the fundamental economic level. Now, Edwards was not naive enough to think that joining labor unions would solve all the Black working class's problems, but she saw it as an important step for Black workers to reclaim their dignity and agency in the workplace. Though the ILGWU did not make grounds in the Sapkin factories in 1935, the workers continued to fight, and in 1937, they successfully established a union. While Edwards' foray into direct union organizing had limited success, her articles show that her persistence to the centrality of labor in the struggle for racial justice. Furthermore, her approval of the 1933 communist-led strike confirmed her attitude that radicalism has a place among Black workers. A few years earlier, in her autobiographical notes, she had written, quote, from its inception as free labor, Negro labor had elements of radicalism and class consciousness. And though the union efforts among Sopkin workers only furthered her expanding education in radical notions of organizing. Now, Edwards' story here takes off in such a magnificent direction that I can only barely begin to talk about what she next went on to work with. But since her studies in Denmark, Edwards had always had a keen interest in international events. And so she began to organize so in 1936, she organized a teaching seminar where 23 interracial students, mostly teachers and social workers, sailed with Edwards to the Soviet Union. Edwards' expedition to the Soviet Union was not unprecedented, as we saw Maud White had made the same journey. Indeed, other notable Black Americans such as Lovett Fort Whiteman, Langston Hughes, Louise Thompson, and Herbert Newton had been visiting the Soviet Union for years, attracted to its strict policy of non-discrimination under communist rule. Like those who came before, Edwards sought to explore race relations of the country and compare them to that of the United States. She wrote back to Robert Abbott of the Chicago Defender, claiming that, quote, perhaps nowhere in the world is there such a mixture of races, and for the first time in history, racial friction has been destroyed. She toured the Soviet Union schools and theaters and writing positively on their efforts. When she returned to the United States, she still had an eye on international travels. She yearned to return to Europe, this time closer to the fight against fascism. With some finagling, Edwards found herself in Barcelona documenting the loyalist efforts in the Spanish Civil War. She admired their struggle for freedom and democracy, but their fight as one with African Americans. The anti-fascist struggle was essential because she said, quote, certainly there isn't going to be any freedom and equality for Negroes until and unless there is a free world. And while the fight against fascism was in Spain for Black Americans like Edwards, it was close to home. One poster read, the fight for democracy in Spain is the fight against lynching and Jim Crow discrimination right here. Edwards returned to the United States and continued her organizing work, this time in New York. Her close work with communists in Chicago labeled her as a red, and in 1942, she was investigated by the Subversive Personnel Committee of the FBI. She clearly denied ever having been a member of the Communist Party. And honestly, her writing showed a sophisticated evolution of radical thought, one independent from the party doctrine. And so she was never arrested nor prosecuted. Her health, though, started to decline after the age of 40. She continued to lecture, organize seminars to Europe and Mexico, and serve as the managing editor of The People's Voice, a leftist newspaper out of New York City. There she met Murray Gitlin, a radical Jewish writer, activist, and lawyer, and together they would travel the country and world, exploring the challenges of interracial marriage and fighting for racial class and gender equality. However, her health caught up with her, and she died in 1953 at the age of 56. These brief introductions to the lives of Maud White and Tyra Edwards are but two examples of how African-American women in the Midwest worked in and around the American Communist Party. For many, their stories have been pushed aside and rendered not as important as their Black male leaders. But within the past two decades, historians have begun to really focus on these women as essential thinkers, activists, and leaders in their own rights. And I will leave you with homework if you so desire to accept it. My work is a part of a growing, wonderful library of scholarly work on Black radical women. And I highly encourage you to check out these volumes, Dale Gore, Eric McDuffie, Greg Andrews, and of course, Carol Boyce Davies' foundational volume and biography of Claudia Jones. Additionally, I do want to make sure that other activists are acknowledged for the work they're continuing to do, institutions that are trying to keep, that are keeping the legacy of Maud White and Tyra Edwards alive, specifically, of course, the Claudia Jones School for Political Education, the Black Midwest Initiative out of Minneapolis, and the Black Metropolis Research Consortium out of Chicago. And lastly, all of these images I have shown you today, I have gotten through digital means from digital archivists, specifically those at Marxist.org. So a big thank you to all those who have made doing research during the pandemic possible through digitization. So I will stop that share and I look forward to your questions.
Lucy, you're muted.
Melissa, I'm curious as to whether either one of these women met Claudia Jones.
So that's a great question. Yes, Maud White was definitely in Claudia Jones's circles. I mean, it's not like we have letters or anything that we can trace them to, but they're in New York at the same time doing with the same, running in the same circles, if you will.
I'm wondering if maybe we should have a little music while people put their questions in Q&A. Oh, I see we do have some more questions, okay.
Okay, someone asked for the books. I will go ahead and post those into chat. Okay.
I would like to say that a recording of this webinar will be available on our YouTube channel following this presentation. So you'll get all of the items that Melissa posted in the recording.
Here we go, they're in chat now. Uh-huh. I do see some questions here, and one is such a huge one. We have a question. To explain the first 10 years of the CPUSA and how it went from direct party organizing to organizing through popular front groups and why. Well, that's one of those huge loaded questions in American history, in American communist history, and one that I cannot begin to pretend to serve as an expert on. For the purposes of, I think, my presentation and the women I'm studying, it showed that the Communist Party finally began to, in 1928 and 1929, realize the specific conditions of African-American people and highlight them as essential components of the working class struggle. Now, this, of course, comes from the Comintern, so it comes very top down. It comes from the it comes as a proclamation, basically, to say that, hey, American communists, now you have to think towards Black workers and Black women. But what I think is important for that transition goes from and in practicality, it goes from the Communist Party as being people trying to make their way into the AFL or to the Democratic Party, to people that said, hey, fine, we're going to make our own organization and we're going to make Black workers central to it. So what it says to Black women is something that they've always known, that they are central parts of the working class struggle. But to get that many of these networks now, and as we see with Maude White and Tyra Edwards and many others, this training, the education that the Communist Party could afford really opens new avenues. So that those 10 years is literally, there's, you know, 10,000 books written about it. Maybe not literally, but it's an important part to remember that it's the Communist Party internationally kind of putting this down, and many women like Maude White saying like, well, yeah, I was ready the whole time. I was just waiting for you. And then be able to take it into the third period. And from there, the Popular Front. All right.
Lucy, there's still more questions in the Q&A. I don't know if you want to ask them.
Actually, I'd appreciate it if the person who's asking the question would put their name in the chat. And since I don't see it,
It looks like if you, in the little Q&A tab at the bottom.
Oh, I see the questions, but I don't see the name. And I mean, in this school, we're not anonymous.
There's a question from Keelan Bradley, I think.
Ah, okay.
Did you see that? They ask, can you talk about the research archives for these women and whether they procured an archive of their work in activism? Yes, I would love to talk to you about archives. This is a very difficult journey. Maude White and Tyra Edwards were known, but they're known for their activism after the 1940s, because after the 1940s, they began to work in New York and on the international level. To look and work at that activists are doing in the Midwest during the 1930s and that Black women are doing is there's a huge dearth of information, because you're falling into several pitfalls there. Midwestern history in general has been less studied than New York or Southern history. Communist history, of course, is always going to be a very complicated archival process. But then for these women like Maude White, she never left behind an autobiography. She did give an interview a few years before the end of her life, which was great, and we have that, and that's fantastic. But it's nowhere near what we have with other Communist Party leaders. Tyra Edwards is really interesting. The Communist Party obviously never sought to collect her archives or any of her work, even though she was very much running in similar circles. So all of her work is now centered out of Chicago and the Chicago History Museum. And in the Chicago History Museum is her unpublished autobiography. And once I get, you know, another year or two together, I'm going to publish that, because it's a fascinating, wonderful history about how she goes from this, you know, teacher in Texas to a global explorer and educator and radical thinker in all of this. So the archives are always going to be the challenge for people doing these types of work. And I'm really inspired by the authors that I showed you in chat there, who have really paved the way in thinking about how to use things like the Schomburg libraries in New York, as well as NYU and the Tamament. But then also, a lot of it is, in for Midwestern history especially, is trying to figure out other creative ways around those loopholes. So no, there's no central archives. That is very sad. But as we continue to celebrate these women, we have to continue to make sure we can celebrate them for a long time.
Lucy, are you able to see the questions now, or are you still having some issue?
I think I'm having some issue.
Okay, I can hop in if
yes. That helps.
Give me a sec. Apologies for the technical issues, folks. It's all good. Sorry, Melissa.
It's great. I can see the question, so I'm trying to think of ways to answer them.
So I had one question, and apologies, folks. I'm Dante. I'm working in the background on the tech for the event. So, but I had a question based off the criticisms that you discussed on your first presentation of Maude White, saying that she basically left the party because of her experience with racism and sexism within the party. I'm curious if anything changed when, Elizabeth Gurley Flynn was the party leader, the chairwoman in the early 60s, I believe, for a brief period. I think she was chairwoman for like 2 years or something like that. So I'm curious if Maude White was still in the party at that point and if anything changed from her experience. Like, obviously, Gurley Flynn was a white woman, so things are different, but I know Gurley Flynn was also a serious fighter against racism, so I'm just curious about that specific experience.
Yeah, and that's such an interesting question. And Gurley Flynn was also also friends with Claudia Jones. But in the early 1960s, to go back, does one ever really leave the Communist Party is a kind of a big question. Once a party member, you're, at least during this time, always kind of associated with them. And so for Maude White, I don't know if she ever officially left the party. She drifted away, I think was the term she used. And so, but in 1960, that need for radical agitation had already been filled by the other organizations like the Freedom Ways and the National Association, or the Negro Women's Action Committee with Louise Thompson Patterson and Vicki Garvin. And so those needs were being filled outside of the CPUSA. And I think that's what's fabulous is these women were all together realizing their collective experiences that they could provide that solidarity and working class support for Black women that the Communist Party had neglected to. Oh, you're muted.
Well, thank you for that answer. I was just mostly curious because Maude White herself is only mentioned very briefly in a lot of autobiographies and texts about the party. So I think this was very good information. And, you know, I learned a lot. I'd be curious to learn from someone, you know, I don't know if she had any kids or folks that like knew her that are still alive or came into passing with, you know, folks that were close to her. That's always a curious thing because, you know, I hate to give you a hard time because, you know, you're academic, but, you know, working class folks typically have different approaches to how they talk about these folks.
Yeah, and it's interesting that you mentioned that because Maude White had two children, and that was part of why she became so involved in the anti-racist struggle in the New York City public schools. And also one thing you'll notice for academics out there or students or anybody who works on a project that takes longer than 5 years, you have to repeatedly Google the names and things you're doing to see if anyone else has come up with something in the 5 years you've been working on your project. So just last week I Googled Maude White Katz, and apparently she has a granddaughter who is now carrying on her legacy in education. So that article is like from last year. So all of this is coming in a really important moment that people are understanding that it wasn't, oh, grandma's off doing a weird thing. It's, oh, these were incredibly important moments that had been marginalized because of race, class, and gender, now are coming back to the center of our core experience of what it truly means to be a free people. And so I think that's just lovely when people are rediscovering that history and very excited for what more people will discover about their past.
Thanks a lot. So there's a lot of questions coming in the Q&A, but I was curious, Lucy, if you had any questions on behalf of yourself before we go into those.
Melissa, what piqued your interest in Black history?
I came across the name Claudia Jones. As a political...
Before when you started, as a researcher.
Yeah.
What got you started?
Right. So, I mean, honestly, I was always interested in working class history and Marxism, and that's what I studied in college was political theory and democratic theory and old white guy theory. And when I went to grad school and learned that there are women like Claudia Jones who were putting it into such a different iteration and making it so much more fulfilling and enriching and lively, it blew my mind, honestly. And so I think Carol Boyce Davies' book, Left of Karl Marx, is like the marker for, if we just go ahead and advertise it. But this is like, I wouldn't say my Bible, but it was one of those books that, you know, challenges the way you think about everything. And so once I learned about Jones, I was like, there's gotta be more. And there are so many women. Some of them do have their biographies being written, which is great, but some of them don't. I mean, the communist newspapers, specifically Working Woman, which is the women's publication for the Communist Party during the Great Depression, has tons of letters that are just signed a Negro working woman. So a woman who doesn't have a name, but is sharing her experience and saying that she believes in the party, she believes in collective organizing and workers coming together, but we'll never know her name. But I think that's such an important part of the communist history experience. And then also Black radicalism is these women who don't have their names, who don't have the biographies, but are still experiencing experiencing and living through this activism in recognizable ways. So I think, and then to also bring it back, to look at one part I briefly mentioned in the beginning is to look at how the Midwest plays into this. I was in graduate school working on this project when Ferguson uprising happened. And to hear pundits and commentators be like, how could this happen in Missouri? How could this happen in the Midwest with the amber waves of grain? And I'm thinking, and like, are you kidding me? I'm studying the 1930s. I'm studying this violence against people of color in St. Louis, in Chicago, in Detroit, in Cleveland. The Midwest is not amber waves of grain. It is built on the oppression and blood of marginalized people of color for centuries. This notion of a conservative prairie land is a myth. And so thinking about how the Midwest has been framed and how Black radical women have continually been pushed out of that narrative has become really important project for me, because as we see with Black Lives Matter today, Minneapolis, Kenosha, Black women are leaders everywhere. In Pittsburgh, we have a remarkable story of Danielle Brown, who is protesting for more information at Duquesne University for her son's very suspicious death. It's a huge issue, but it was a Black woman on the streets who was on a hunger strike for months to get answers and justice. And this is happening in these, you know, quiet Western Pennsylvania or, you know, outskirts of St. Louis, these towns that are supposedly conservative and typical American towns, when none of that has ever been the case. So I get a little angry when I've been lied to. And so part of my project has been to show the receipts and saying that no, Black women's radical agitation, labor organizing, community organizing has always been here.
Also with the decline of union membership, because of the decline of, because union jobs were sent abroad, I think a lot of people don't know what a company union is as opposed to a people's union. If you'd talk a little bit about that.
Well, this comes on, 2 days ago that Amazon workers in Alabama announced a union. So we're on such an interesting moment of union and labor history right now. But a company union is essentially, it's a union that the company sponsors or owns. So it's as if Amazon said, okay, you can join Amazon union. And hopefully you'd enter that knowing that there's absolutely no, at the end of the day, company union's goals are to best represent the company, not the workers. And so a company union is a mouthpiece for management. It is not a friend of the worker at all. And so for Sopkin specifically in 1930, 5 to say, look, you can have a union. It just has to be my union. It's just so utterly with the times. It's exactly on par with other white management, other owners in, during that time who employ mostly African-American women. And you know, one thing I didn't mention, but in 1933, in July, we have the Sopkin strike. In 2 months or 2 weeks earlier in May, we have a strike very similarly in St. Louis, Missouri, where about 1,500 African-American women struck from a nut picking factory. That's called the Funston Nut Factory. And so again, the communists got involved, radicalized these women, and they formed their own union. But given the times, the companies then moved their factories to the South, where they were less likely to organize. And so there's this always these, in radical history especially, there's always these one step forward, two step backs, a little here, and then you lose some, a little more, and then you lose some. And it is especially difficult when thinking about Midwestern history.
All right, so there's a few in the Q&A, so I wanted to get to those so folks don't feel left out. There was a few by, apologies for mispronouncing your name if I do. It's Naf Nayetz or Knights. Probably just wanna ask them all at once. So was Maud White queer? What do people who take classes on these topics go on to do for work? How does this knowledge get spread? And then can you talk a little bit more about the experiences White had that radicalized her? I think there was one more. I would like to also hear more about the organizing tactics that these women learned and used.
Okay. So for, I don't want to comment on Maud White's sexualities. I don't know. So I'm not going to. But for like the classes they took, I think that's such an interesting question, because when you hear like, oh, I went to the Soviet Union to take classes on how to be a worker or organizer, like, what does that look like? Do you have a textbook? Do you write papers? Do you have homework? Is your homework to go organize a strike? But it, for these programs in the 1930s, they are very much just like a college classroom. You would go, you would pick up a book on the history of a certain area of labor activism and agitation, and that would be your kind of lesson for the week. Let's look at how workers in 1877 were part of the railroad strike. Now, what were their theories? What went right? What went wrong? How do we learn from this? Discuss the big ideas as well as the very local specifics. And so how does this knowledge get spread? Well, that's part of that is every student then becomes a teacher. The idea isn't for Maud White to go to the Soviet Union to learn something and then just sit alone and not do anything. It's for her to come back and share and teach. And really, she was an excellent teacher. She considered herself a teacher in many ways in organizations of sharing that information with Black women who would never have the opportunity to go to the Soviet Union, but these working class women who were there to learn and to support the other workers in their community. So if that, I think this goes to the question, what about these organizing tactics? Things just like how to form a picket line. That sounds probably pretty basic to us today, but picket lines and the kind of the reinforcements and keeping the strength, organizing who's there, when they're there, who gets breaks, who gets food, how to pay for this, collecting donations. There's a lot of organizing that goes into this. And that's something that Communist Party was very good at training these women to do, because then they would go on to their neighborhoods and local organizations to continue that work. And I think one other question about Maud White, because I'm really interested in her experience in the Midwest. And she's from, I think I mentioned, McKeesport, which is just down the road for me, figuratively. One of the radicalizing experiences for her that she mentioned several times in interviews is that she had a white English teacher who was a communist, who took a special interest in her and took her to a meeting in Pittsburgh to hear Scott Nearing, who was an economic Marxist, who taught at Penn, I think. And so that it's, so we have a white teacher, her young Black student going to Pittsburgh to listen to this Marxist speaker. And when they come out of the meeting, they still have another hour or so to kill before their ride comes. So they decide to go into a restaurant in downtown Pittsburgh in 1927. And so Maude White knows exactly what's going to happen. She's like, we're not going to get service. It's fine. Let's just go home. It's fine. I don't care. And her teacher, this radical white communist, was like, no, we will demand to see management. We will demand to be fed. We will eat our food here and we will be happy. Not we will be happy, but we will be not be embarrassed about doing it because it is our human rights. And this is something that was really informative for Maude, who grew up in a small town where she was one of the only Black families who just kind of kept her nose down. And she wanted to be a missionary until she came across this idea that no, she has fundamental human rights that are being completely stripped and exploited. And so the party really opened that door for her. So sometimes all it takes is one person, which I think is a fabulous story for Maude.
Yeah, I would also mention to the, I think the first question was, or second question was, you know, where do people learn about these things? And I think that's one of the goals of our school, right? You know, popular education, you know, sort of like, you know, you're not going to learn a lot of these things going to a typical U.S. high school or university, like unless you have a communist teacher, right? So we need more communist teachers and professors. But yeah, I think for folks that are looking for more like radical politics or learning about people that we know nothing about, you know, radical bookstores, popular education centers or schools like our own, and organizations as well, obviously, right? So, and you know, Lucy and I are members of the Claudia Jones School, and we're trying to, you know, build here in DC. So if folks are in the DMV area, y'all should be coming out to our events, or when we're back in person, come see us and, you know, get that political education. So, so I just kind of want to plug that for a second. And I know also the Southern Workers Assembly, that's very involved with the Amazon Union Drive in Bessemer. They're all about worker education as well, and organizer training as well. So that's extremely important work. So solidarity with that effort and et cetera. There's another question in the Q&A from Scott Marshall. I see Scott's writing in the chat, why is he being ignored? You're not being ignored. We're just engaging in conversation. So please be patient. Isn't it true that the CPUSA played a dynamic role in the Communist International and was very influential in arguing for a united front or a popular front approach?
I guess they're talking there about CPUSA leadership and the Comintern. And honestly, that's not my area of communist history. I'm very bottom up, and that looks at a lot of that, what that leadership is doing. And honestly, I don't want to misspeak or anything. So I'm not sure. I just know it was incredibly influential, right? We have people being brought together that for so long had been on the opposite sides of the table. But that was really the moment where women like Maude White and Tyra Edwards were able to shine and show these coalition building skills. So I don't want to misspeak there.
Cool. A few more questions. There's a comment by Joe Henry, and I think Melissa, you were on our previous panel about Edna Griffin, where Joe spoke from Iowa. So he had a comment saying, in our research of Edna Griffin, Communist Party leader in Iowa from the 1940s to the 90s, we would agree with Melissa that the story about her party work had not been acknowledged until a graduate student had written her story for a school assignment. More needs to be done to uncover the work of Black women in the party and the civil rights movement.
Yeah, I love that panel about Edna Griffin, because as someone who did work on radical Black women in the Midwest, and I didn't know about this radical Black women in the Midwest, my mind was blown, but that just always continues to prove the point that they have been ignored, and all it takes, and we need to go into archives with our blinders open, right? With our minds open, and see that one name that you may see once, but find out what more is there. And that's such a luxury and privilege that grad students and professors and academics have that most people do not. But I think this goes back to the digitization efforts of our libraries, museums, and archives across the country are making it more and more accessible. And so score one for the internet there, at least, being able to access these archives from your own home, because I know Edna Griffin's stuff is all online, and I've been looking at that and wondering what type of paper I can write with her stuff. So I think it's not perfect for sure, but when you do come across these stories, you have to fight to keep them alive.
All right, we have another question from Stephen Fritsch. Speaking about racism and class struggle in the US during this period, where are we today? Do you think racism is still rampant in left politics? And how do you feel about speaking about Black women radicals as a white woman?
Yes, racism is still rampant everywhere. Let's just get that out. I'm not exactly sure where the question is going, but I can answer this last one, and I hope to be honest with you. How do I feel speaking about Black women as obviously a white woman? I think my role as an academic, as a teacher, as an educator, and as a human being is to use what privileges I have by nature of how I look or how I was born, and amplify those voices and bodies who do not have those privileges. And so I never intend or imply to speak for these women or speak for people in certain positions, but my only intent is here to amplify those voices and to be an ally in whatever way I can. And I found that being an academic and writing these stories, that I have time to and have the luxury of being able to share it with people is how I can best amplify their voices. And so they continue to be heard today. And so it's an interesting question. It's something we have to continue to think about for sure, is where and how do we see ourselves enter? And it's important to understand that it's okay not to be at the forefront. I'm just here to help amplify the voices.
Yeah, thank you for that answer. And I would just say that white workers, white people in general, but white workers have a special obligation to fight racism. So, and I think your scholarship is contributing to that work, Melissa. So, you know, we try to put together a panel for this event, folks that were not available. But we hope to have Melissa back for another panel to be in discussion and dialogue with other Black, either academics or working class women. Just the timing just didn't work out for this time. But I would say, reiterate again, I think white workers have a special obligation to fight racism. We cannot do this alone as Black people in this country. So that's all I gotta say on that. We have another question. Okay, we had one from YouTube, but I think this is probably a short answer. Is Melissa Ford a communist?
Oh, I am not, nor ever have been, a card-carrying member of the communist. Why does it matter? What is a communist? And that is literally what J.C. Austin, who was a reverend, a Black reverend, who started in Pittsburgh, moved to Chicago. He has Black members of his church. They're working class. It's 1935. Everyone is unemployed and poor. Angelo Herndon comes into town, a famous communist who had been struggling for his independence because of his all sorts of interesting things. And J.C. Austin, Reverend Austin, goes in front of his congregation and says, you guys need to go out and support this man, because what is a communist? If it means loving your fellow man and wanting to better everyone, then I'm a communist. And this is a Black reverend saying this from his pulpit in Chicago in the 1930s. What is a communist? Why, I hate to be like, why labels? But it's, I don't, who cares? One of my articles about the Sopkin strikes in 1933 is called What if they are communists? What if the women are communists? What if I am a communist? So what? What if I'm not a communist? So what? And I don't mean to be defensive about this. It's just...
Well, I think that's one of the sort of, I'm blanking on the word, but one of like the sort of key things in like United Front politics or Popular Front, like the idea of, you know, so-called communists working with liberals is actually, you know, folks that are less radical allowing communists into their space to move things forward, right? And it's kind of fighting the red baiting from the right and fighting the anti-communism from the ruling class, which for some folks on this call, I'm sure folks know that anti-communism and racism are twin weapons from the ruling class. So it's specifically used to divide us up. So we should all be communists. That's my take. But I'll try to get to another question here. Let's see. Okay, so how can students, specifically graduating seniors, engage with your organization? Are there career opportunities? I don't know if this is specific to the Claudia Jones School or your university.
I don't have any career opportunities. If I would, I'd give you all jobs right now. So that maybe you, do you have a job opportunity?
Well, Lucy, do you want to answer that question? We
have volunteer opportunities. Right now we don't have any salaried positions.
I do want to answer, I think I can kill two questions with one stone. John W. asks, you seem to imply that in a capitalist system, there is something more radical than fighting class oppression. How can that be considered a Marxist point of view? And then Scott Marshall asks, do you know why the book is called To the Left of Marx? And so both of these can be answered in the person of Claudia Jones. Something that is even more Marxist than Marx is fighting race, class, gender oppression and seeing the intersectionality of that. And to be more Marxist than Marx is to be left of Marx, right? But in Highgate Cemetery, which is where both Claudia Jones and Karl Marx are buried, Claudia Jones's grave marker is to the left of Marx. So she is literally and ideologically left of Marx, which is why it is the best title of a book ever. And I'm so mad that Carol Boyce Davies took the best title ever, but it's so great. So definitely read it.
And one of our first presentations was by the author of that book. So if people want to listen to Carol Boyce Davies, they can go to our YouTube channel and check it out.
Yeah, shout out to Dr. CBD. She is awesome and extremely supportive of our school, and we hope to have her, even you, Melissa, in person once we're able in the future. Get y'all vaccines. all right. I think there's one last question. Oh, no, another one actually just popped up. So Dorit Gordon, I really don't think Kotz or Edwards were truly communists. It were more so of a choice of access that otherwise would not have been an opportunity within their own community. What is your take on this thought?
So I guess this, again, it goes back to how do you define communist? And this is why I made up my own term for my upcoming book is Midwestern Black Radical, because people who, many of these women who were engaged in one or two events or activities with the Communist Party would not consider themselves communists, but they're absolutely in line with all of these radical ideologies that the Communist Party third period doctrine espoused. So what do you call them? Are they Black radicals? Are they pseudo-communists? Are they fellow travelers? Well, they're Black radicals in their own right, and they're responding to very specific points in their life. That doesn't make them any less radical or any less leftist. It makes them using their personal and lived experiences to inform their actions and ideologies. Technically, yes, Maud Whitecat signed a card. She was a communist for her entire life. Technically, Tyra Edwards, no, never signed the card. She denied being a communist. And is that where the conversation about their ideologies ends? I say that's where it begins. because we're just learning and continuing to learn more and more and more about how much more there is than just check this box, yes or no, are you a communist?
All right, I think we have one more question. Maybe we can get one more in. Someone's asking in the chat if you're from Pittsburgh, because someone's from Pittsburgh, okay. So if you want to answer that in chat, but one last question here from John Gonsalves. Did Maud White reflect on her time in Scandinavia relating to experiences with colleagues, students, and being a communist there?
So I think the questioner may have mixed up Maud White and Tyra Edwards, which is fine because I talk really fast and they had very similar life experiences. But Tyra Edwards was the one who spent an extended amount of time in Denmark. And yes, she does, has these amazing journal entries. And some of them get quite, let's say, intimate about her time among Scandinavian people. And she talks about just like this beautiful ideal vision of just staying up late at night talking about Marx and Lenin and these big theories, you know, philosophies of what is life and how do they enter into this world. But it's an untapped resource that we have. We have it, we just haven't looked at it yet. And that's extremely frustrating, but also very exciting for me as a historian, is to say, wow, there's a lot more out there. And I look forward to helping to amplify those voices.
All right, so there's no more questions. I don't know if Lucy, you have anything last on your mind or any remarks before we go into announcements?
I think it's announcements time.
All right, well, thank you so much, Melissa, for your outstanding talk and your scholarship. And we're looking forward to that book coming out. You said early next year, right?
Correct.
2022.
All right. So we're looking forward to that. And hopefully we'll be back in person and we'll be able to host a book talk or something.
That sounds great. I'd love to. Love to do it.
Yeah. So we did want to announce we have a celebration of Paul Robeson, his birthday coming up on April 9th. Co-hosted with the Paul Robeson House and Museum in Philadelphia. It'll be all virtual. Folks can register. I'll post a link in the chat. It will be from 7 to 9 p.m., I believe. And it's his 123rd birthday celebration. And we're going to have a bunch of speakers giving some remarks, including Lucy herself on this call, Gerald Horn, and a lot of other folks that a lot of you may know already. So yeah, so there's that. And then if folks want to drop a few coins for us to donate, I will post our Cash App in the chat and also our donation page. And yes, our recording will be on YouTube and also on our website, which I'll also post. Thank you again, Melissa, for your time. And thank you for supporting us as well. That's how we got in contact, because you've been coming to our events. And thank you to those who have been with us since the beginning, who are on this call and will continue this journey with us. So with that, I guess we shall close and I'll post things in the chat in the last 30 seconds or so. But thank you.
Thank you again, Melissa. And good night, everyone.
Good night. Thank you, Lucy. Thank you, Dante.